السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we belong and to him we return. We seek refuge by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the accursed devil and from the adverse consequences of our deeds. And I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah, the most exalted, the most high, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and messenger. Indeed, the best of speech is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the best of guidance is the guidance that our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. And indeed, the worst of matters are the newly invented matters. For every newly invented matter is an innovation, and every innovation is a misguidance, and every misguidance is in the fire of hell. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the fire of hell. First and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and all of you are seated here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa, that is to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be conscious of Him at all moments and at all times, can a true believer attain success in this world, likewise the hereafter. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, on my way to the masjid, I was thinking on how to commence today's khutbah, and likewise in regard to the contents of today's khutbah. For alhamdulillah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward the true scholars of Islam, for they spend their time imparting knowledge, lectures, sermons, inviting people towards goodness, inviting people towards Islam, inviting people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But we, on the other hand, we listen to all these sermons, we listen to these lectures, we listen to these impartations of knowledge, but most of the time, sadly, we leave or we go after the lecture with only information stored in our heads. With only information stored in our heads. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is time to walk the talk, as they say. It is time to walk the talk. For the real purpose of seeking knowledge is not to sow information. if we were to do that, we would become like any other book on the shelf, or perhaps a computer with data, which would not per se benefit a person. It's just information stored. The real purpose behind seeking knowledge is to implement that knowledge in our lives. And this is what our Salaf and the Salih have advised us. This is what the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, advised us, instructed us. Look at the profound statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, who says, لَيْسَ الْعِلْمُ بِكَثْرَةِ الرِّوَايَةِ إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ الْخُشْيَةِ. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he says that knowledge or seeking knowledge is not about collecting many narrations or else giving out many narrations of a hadith, but rather really seeking knowledge is to build in khashya, in other words taqwa, the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Salafun al-Salih have also advised us that in regard to seeking knowledge, the more we seek knowledge, the more we become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, the more we seek knowledge, the more we have to personify that knowledge in our lives. We have to bring it about in our lives. And that is why we see the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, in many instances, they would take, for example, 5 ayat, 5 verses of the Noble Quran, memorize them, study them, ponder upon them, reflect upon them, bring them into their lives, and only then would they move on to the next 5 ayat. Today, many of us are Huffaz al-Quran, but the question that we need to ask ourselves is that, how many of these ayat are in our lives? How many ayat have we brought in? How many of the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have we brought into our lives? Have we taken the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strictly to stay away from all that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited? For this is what taqwa is all about. This is what being conscious of our Maker is all about. So that was one of the secrets behind why the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in used to take it step by step. Because they used to bring it all into their lives. They were living examples of the Noble Quran. This was the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in and our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For only then, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, would knowledge in reality benefit us. And this is why our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith is in Muslim, this is why he used to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala excessively. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa' wa min qalbin la yakhsha' wa min nafsin la tashba' wa min da'watin la yustajab laha. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala often. Ya Allah, I seek refuge in you min ilmin la yanfa', from knowledge that will not avail me, from knowledge that will not benefit me. I seek refuge in you. Because my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we do not need that information. We do not need that knowledge which does not benefit us. If it is not going to benefit us in this world, now that hereafter, what is the point of seeking that knowledge? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make this dua often. So having said all of that, hopefully with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will try to base today's lecture, because we still haven't begun today's lecture, we will try to base today's lecture upon something that would benefit us, and likewise we will all keep firm intention to try and bring it into our lives. So today's khutbah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is going to be about when do we lose our good deeds? When do we lose our good deeds? And why have we based today's khutbah on this particular topic is because a believer, a mu'min, for him, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, his good deeds are the most dearest of assets for him. It is the most valuable of assets. And that is why many of the Salafun al-Salih, if I'm not mistaken, it is either Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah or Imam ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah who says that the amount of importance you give for food, for drink, for your own breathing, you need to give even more importance to your good deeds. For your good deeds are so important to you that that is what is going to give you success in this world and the hereafter. What is the point of being successful in dunya and being an utter loser in akhirah? What is the point? After all, we all know that this stage is a transitory, temporary stage, a matter of 60 to 70 years. We may be successful in this dunya, in this temporary life. It is like being a successful businessman in what? In a train station. What is the point? If you're just passing by, your destination is elsewhere. What is the point of putting up a grand mansion, buying cars and all of that in the train station? Or a bus stop for that matter. Your destination is al-akhirah. This is a temporary stage that we are crossing through. And a'malu salihah, those actions, those good actions are the investments that would secure a good akhirah for us. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, look at this beautiful hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which very beautifully captures this concept. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhumah, he says on the authority of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that من جعل الهموم هما واحدا هم آخرته. The individual who collects all of his concerns, whatever concern he has in this dunya, if he were to gather all of it and sum it up to be one worry, and that worry should be the worry for his akhirah, for his eternal life, كَفَاهُ اللَّهُ هَمَّ دُنْيَاهُ. الله أكبر. كَفَاهُ اللَّهُ هَمَّ دُنْيَاهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would suffice for him in regard to his worries about this temporary world, about this temporary life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would suffice, and Allah would look after all of his affairs, all of his worldly affairs. But as for the individual, وَمَنْ تَشَعَبَتْ بِهِ الْهُمُومُ فِي أَحْوَالِ الدُّنْيَا. As for the individual who lets his worries and concerns be only about the matters of this dunya, only about this temporary life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not care in which valley of this dunya that he destroys himself. Allahu Akbar. Allah would not turn back and look at him, because you are striving for dunya, you are only striving for dunya. I'm not saying that it is haram to strive for dunya, but what I'm trying to highlight here is that priority needs to be given to al-akhirah, because that is the permanent abode we are heading to. But if an individual were to forget al-akhirah and only focus on dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to help him in any of his affairs. Allah the Almighty, he says in the Noble Quran, من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة. من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى, male or female, whoever it may be, if they were to do good deeds, amal and salihah, good deeds, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ, while he or she is a believer, فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah, our beloved maker, he guarantees that we will assure for them a good life in this dunya, where they will be comfortable in this dunya. وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And likewise, we shall reward them بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ, with something much better, with something much greater than what they were doing, than the good deed that they did. We will reward them, we shall reward them in al-akhirah, in Jannah, with something which is far better, with something which is much better. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to the matters of this dunya and in regard to al-akhirah, the more we focus on al-akhirah, the more we prioritize and place that as our goal, our destination, the more we focus on al-akhirah, the matters of dunya become easy for us. This is how you have these magic pictures, blurred images. You know, these pictures are circulated on social media, etc. If you were to focus on a particular point in that image, you would be able to see something else. Another image comes about. If you focus on, they say, focus on this dot, or focus on this particular part of the image, and you would see something. But the minute you lose focus, the minute you lose focus or move away from that particular point or dot, that image blurs. You lose the image. Likewise, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if our focus is al-akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala arranges the matters of this dunya for us in a very easy manner. Every single thing will be facilitated for us. We won't have hardships, we won't have difficulties, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes care of our matters. And even then, if there is an instance where a believer goes through a particular hardship, I have touched on this in other lectures, because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves an individual, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts him through afflictions, him or her, but according to the levels of his iman. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah would never ever burden a soul more than he or she can endure. It is according to the levels of our iman that our tests are tailor-made to suit us, in a way that we will be able to pass it. For that we need to work on our iman. So say a person, an individual, a mu'min, he is going through a particular troublesome patch in his life. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say?
وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا.
As for the one who has placed trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is conscious of Allah the Most High, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah the Almighty would arrange a way for him to come out of that problem.
وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ.
And likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would provide for him in a manner or from in ways that he would never ever have imagined. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allah would provide for him in such a manner that he would never ever have imagined the help of Allah coming as such.
وَمَن يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ.
And likewise, the one who places his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the one who places his trust, tawakkul, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Most High, Allah the Most Exalted, is sufficient for that individual. Allahu Akbar. If all of these concepts are brought about, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, a believer's heart is at peace. A believer's heart is at peace. Nothing would worry him. No affliction would trouble him. Anything that is happening in his life, a test, a trial, a calamity, nothing would trouble him, because his heart is at peace. He has placed his trust with the King of Kings, Allah the Most Exalted, the Most High. He has nothing to worry about. That believer's heart becomes similar to Jannah. Allahu Akbar. That believer's heart becomes similar to paradise. Because peace is never temporary in Jannah. Rather, peace is eternal in Jannah. But the believer who places his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings all of these beautiful concepts within his life, his heart is at eternal peace. His heart is at eternal peace. No worry will afflict him. And this is beautifully captured in the statement of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, who says, truly, indeed, there is a heaven in this world. There is a Jannah in this world. And whoever does not enter that Jannah which is in this world will never enter the Jannah of the Akhirah. And which Jannah is he talking about, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? Shaykh al-Islam is referring to the Jannah which is in a believer's heart. The minute taqwa, tawakkul, khashya, all of these qualities, the minute that individual brings it into his heart is at peace. His heart becomes similar to Jannah. Look at another statement by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He says, and this was narrated by Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah. He says, I heard my beloved teacher, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, saying that what can my enemies do to me? He was a true scholar of Islam. He faced many trials, many calamities, many persecutions. They imprisoned him because he spoke the truth. He spoke the truth. He says, what can my enemies do to me? What can they do to me? Because within my breast or within my chest, in other words, in my heart, I have my Jannah. I have my Jannah. What can my enemies do to me? If they imprison me, if they put me into prison, it will be a religious adini khalwa for me. It will be a religious seclusion for me, where I can spend my time worshipping my beloved Maker, making remembrance of my beloved Maker. So what if they imprison me? He goes on to say, if they kill me, if they assassinate me, I die as a shaheed. I will die as a martyr. I will be flying in Jannah. So what can my enemies do to me? And then finally he says, and even if they were to exile me, if they were to banish me, that will be a new spiritual journey that I shall undertake, along the lines of these words. He says all of this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, because his heart is at peace. He fears none other than Allah Jalla wa Ala. He fears none other than Allah, the Most High, the Most Exalted. His heart is at peace. He is imprisoned. He goes through trials, afflictions, calamities, but nothing wavers him away from his path, his journey towards Al-Akhirah. Towards Al-Akhirah. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to how we lose our good deeds, there are three ways. Few minutes, I'll touch on it and we wrap it up inshallah. Three ways an individual loses his good deeds. Now I highlighted on the importance of good deeds. The three ways a person loses his good deeds. Number one, لِبُطْلَانِ أَصْلِهِ. لِبُطْلَانِ أَصْلِهِ. Number one, because the foundation of a particular good deed or good deed at large was not proper. Was not proper. Scholars of Islam mention it is either due to kufr or riddah. It is either due to kufr, in other words, associating partners unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rejecting the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or else riddah, apostasy, leaving the beautiful religion of Islam. For if an individual is a kafir, he can be a great philanthropist. He can be having great charitable organizations, helping people worldwide. The whole world can be talking about him, can be talking good about him. But the day he leaves this world as a kafir, rejecting the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he stands in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with all of those mountains of charities, mountains of good deeds, what does Allah the Almighty say in regard to this individual?
مثل الذين كفروا بربهم أعمالهم كرماد. مثل الذين كفروا بربهم أعمالهم كرماد.
The parable, the example of an individual who denies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in regard to his good deeds, أعمالهم, the parable that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala suits for his good deeds is that كرماد. It will be like ashes. Ashes. The words of our beloved Maker, we don't read it and cross through it, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Allah the Almighty, He commands us,
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا.
Allah did not say, أَفَلَا يَقْرَأُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Should you all not recite the noble Qur'an? أَفَلَا يَسْمَعُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Should you all not listen to the noble Qur'an? Nay, Allah the Almighty, He says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. Should you all not make tadabbur of the words of your beloved Maker, of the words of the noble Qur'an? Should you all not reflect? Should you all not ponder on these great verses? أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ يَقْفَالُهَا? Or have you all got locks on your heart? Are your hearts all locked up? Can you all not ponder on the words of the Qur'an? So we need to ponder on every single ayah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And coming back to the example of the kuffar, their good deeds, karamad, and Allah does not stop there. Karamadin ishtaddat bihi ar-rihu fi yawmin 'asif. Their good deeds will be like ashes being blown away, bihi ar-rih, by a wind, fi yawmin 'asif, on a stormy day. How is the wind on a stormy day? How is the wind? We see dust going like in whirlwinds on a stormy day. On that day, you know, ashes are so feeble, light things. When you burn paper or something, ashes, you blow it with your own mouth, it flies away. Trivial, insignificant. They can come with mountains of good deeds, but due to the butlan of their asl, due to their foundation of those good deeds not being proper, all of that will be rejected. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. So that is cause number one. Number two, lifawati sharti. Lifawati sharti. Due to the conditions not being met, amalu salihah, your good deeds will not be accepted if the conditions are not met. And the final cause is لِضَيَاءِ ثَوَابِهِ وَأَجْرِهِ, which we will not be going into as time does not permit. But let me wrap up with the second cause. لِفَوَاتِ شَرْطِ. If the conditions are not met. Now what are the conditions? Condition number one, إِخْلَاف. All of us, we're striving. Why did all of us come to the masjid? Why did we all come to the masjid? Did we come to have a nap? Did we come because everybody is going to the masjid? Why? Because it is an obligation. It is a good deed. It is from our religion. Why do we come to the masjid to pray? Why do we give sadaqat out? Why do we help a brother Muslim? All of these are good deeds. But what's the point, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if we were to pray 1,000 rakats for a day, and it is not going to be accepted? Condition number one, ikhlas. Every single action of ours is based upon our intention, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Every single action of ours. There is no action that we do without an intention. Unless, and of course, if it is a sneeze, or perhaps we sleep. Whilst you are sleeping, even if you are going to sleep, you intend to sleep. Sometimes you ask one another, did you do it intentionally? Did you do it intentionally or unintentionally? We don't understand the gravity of the statement. What we are trying to say is intention. Every single action is based upon our intention. So why do we come to the masjid? Are we coming because to show off to people? Why do we pray in the first place? To show off to people? Why am I giving out so many millions to the masjid to show off for people? Or is it for the sake of my beloved Maker that no one should know other than Him, because I am doing it for His pleasure alone? Condition number one, ikhlas. We do every single thing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Condition number two, it should be according to how our beloved Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, taught us. In accordance to His guidance, in accordance to the manner that He taught us, we do our good deeds. A person can't come and say, today is Jum'ah Salah, you know, I feel spiritually enlightened, I want to make 4 rakats. It's 2 rakats, I want to make 4 rakats. I'll get more good deeds, of course. He comes saying that. Will that be accepted? Will that be accepted? Or he says, I want to make 6 rakats, I'll get 3 times the good deeds then. No. That his salah is not valid at all. He has to pray it again. Because you have to follow the teachings of our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إخلاص and following the teachings of our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the two conditions in regard to the second cause. Why I brought this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is because we need to put our intentions right. At times we think that intention is something that we need to, for example, if you're going to make salah, you keep your intention before the salah and that's it. We think that the intention is only just before salah and that's it. At times we see people, the imam, he ties takbir and he's almost going to ruku and the individual is still struggling with his intention. We know that the place of intention is the heart. So what I'm trying to highlight here, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is that intention is not only in the beginning of your amal, but rather it is something continuous. It has to go on throughout the action. Say you start a project for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a charitable project. In the beginning, you are like, I'm doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't need the fame, the power, the money, nothing. But halfway through, maybe after 2 or 3 years, now that the project has become big, it's all about fame, it's all about authority, it's all about the seat, it's all about power. Intentions have changed. So throughout the project, throughout the good deed that you are involved in, we need to refine our intentions that whatever we do, it is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is extremely important. For we being in the fold of Islam, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we need to look after these two conditions to guarantee the acceptance of our good deeds by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, and may He fill all of our good deeds with ikhlas, with sincerity, that we do every single good deed, however minute it be. Even if it be a tiny date that we give in charity, let it be for the sake of Allah alone and for His pleasure alone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins and unite us in the gardens of Jannah.